Hello everyone, and welcome to the Slightly Scientific Podcast. I'm Oliver, and today I'm going to be joined by Finley and Oscar. We are going to be interviewing the person who designed the COVID-19 Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, Professor Sarah Gilbert. This was an incredible opportunity, and by the end of the interview, we literally had pages of fascinating notes on things like the platform technology that they used to why children don't spread COVID-19 as much as the other viruses such as the flu. It was an absolutely amazing interview, and we are so glad that we are able to share it with you.
What was your role in the process of developing the COVID-19 AstraZeneca vaccine?
Well, I work on the early development of vaccines against novel pathogens. Pathogens that can cause outbreaks. So viruses like Nipah virus, Lassa fever virus, Middle East respiratory syndrome, and that's another coronavirus. And I've been working on ways of making vaccines against these viruses that we don't have any vaccines against using the same technology each time. So we call it a platform technology. It's a way of making a vaccine that you can then adapt to make lots of different vaccines. And what's different about this from traditional approaches is that you put most of the work into developing the technology, and then you've got all of that work already done when you want to start making a new vaccine. So what I do is decide which viruses we're going to make a new vaccine against and exactly how we're going to do that. And then with my small team in the lab in Oxford, we make the first small batch of that vaccine and start getting it tested.
And so you said a small team. How many like people? So that's just like in developing it, right? Yeah. How many people were involved in the making of like the vaccine?
Well, it starts off with a very small team. There are, I think, four of us involved on the first weekend getting started. And then that spread to about another four making it in the lab and starting to test it. It went over to our manufacturing facility, which is where we produce vaccine that we can use in clinical trials. Because if we're going to vaccinate somebody with a vaccine that's made in the university, it can only be made in a very specialized facility. Everything is very, very tightly controlled. And it's an approved facility to making vaccines. The MHRA that license vaccines, they also license the manufacturing facilities, and it regularly gets inspected. So there's a team of about 30 people, and they made the first batch of vaccine that went into the first clinical trials. That started exactly a year ago today, because it's April the 23rd that we're recording this. So it's our first year anniversary of when we started that trial. And then the team really starts to get a lot bigger. So we had probably 50 people originally involved in starting the clinical trial in Oxford. But by the time we'd got enough information from our phase one trial to publish, the author list on the first paper that we published was 600 people. So it starts growing quite quickly. And then we partnered with AstraZeneca, and they started manufacturing the vaccine at much larger scale. So to take into our later clinical trials and also for the supply that's being used around the world now. And there's a very large team there, and they're working with about 20 or more different manufacturers around the world. So we're now into tens of thousands of people who are involved in producing this vaccine for the actual supply that's being used around the world.
Is this a typical number of people for vaccine development and research, or is this different?
Well, I think that the different thing here is that we wouldn't normally be doing all of these phases at the same time. So one of the reasons it's such a large number is that the manufacturing for the global supply is happening. That's huge numbers of people. But we're still doing the clinical trials. So we've produced data from the clinical trials about the safety, about the immune responses, and about the efficacy of the vaccine. But we're still continuing to run those trials, and our volunteers come back now roughly every 6 months, give us another blood sample so that we can look at the maintenance of the immune responses. And that's all still happening. In normal times, you'd probably finish your clinical trials before you actually start doing the very large scale manufacturing. So that's what's different about this one.
How does the AstraZeneca vaccine work?
So what we do is use a different kind of virus, an adenovirus, to make the vaccine. So adenoviruses are things that cause infections in people quite regularly, but they're really mild infections. So we just get a cold. So sometimes we'll have a cough or a sniffle, runny nose, and we don't know that it's an adenovirus infection, but sometimes that kind of thing is. So we can take an adenovirus and make it safer to use as a vaccine by taking one of its genes out. And that means when we inject it into somebody, it can't spread in their body. It can just go into the first cell it finds, and it can't spread any further. So it's very safe to use. But actually, the adenovirus that we use doesn't normally circulate amongst people, because if we used one of those adenoviruses, it would mean that some people will have been infected with it before and they'll have antibodies against it. And that reduces the ability of the vaccine based on a human adenovirus to give a good immune response. So we use an adenovirus that's normally found in chimpanzees. Genetically, it's very similar. It has a very similar effect to the adenoviruses that infect humans normally. It's just that it doesn't normally infect humans, so people don't already have an immune response against the vector. So that's the technology that we use. But what we need to do to make a vaccine with it is add the gene for the protein from the pathogen that we want to have an immune response against. So for the coronavirus, it's the spike protein. And the spike protein is the one that covers the surface of the coronavirus. And there's only one protein on the surface of a coronavirus. So it's quite easy to decide what the antigen should be in the vaccine. It's completely obvious. So we take the gene that encodes that protein, we add it into our adenovirus. And then when we inject somebody with the adenovirus, it will go inside cells at the injection site and make lots of that spike protein. And the immune system then recognizes that as being something that's foreign. So the purpose of our immune system is to work out if there's something new that shouldn't be there. It's to recognize invaders, if you like. So it's constantly patrolling the body, looking for something novel, something foreign, and then it will attack. So when the adenovirus goes inside the body and makes lots of this spike protein, the immune system recognizes that that's something new, and it starts to make an immune response against it. And when we get that immune response, that results in immune memory. And the next time the body sees that coronavirus spike protein, which might be on the surface of a real live coronavirus causing an infection, that immune memory is there already, and it can respond very quickly and attack the coronavirus and stop it making us ill. So that's how vaccines work in general, to show the body something from the pathogen, to encourage it to make an immune response and lay down that immune memory. There are different technologies for doing that, and the one we use is an adenovirus.
Is there anything you have to do to the adenovirus to make the chimpanzee adenovirus to make it like kind of infect humans?
No, it will infect humans anyway. It's very similar to a human adenovirus, and it could, the wild type virus, if we didn't modify it, it could cause a cold in a human. It's just that it normally circulates amongst chimpanzees, and there's not a lot of contact between humans and chimps, so you tend not to get infections with the chimpanzee adenoviruses.
How is it how is the COVID-19 vaccine different to the other vaccines that you've helped develop?
Well, some of the other ones I've worked on recently also use this simian adenovirus. We call it ChAdOx1. And so the only difference there is the antigen that we've added into it. So, for example, I've been working on a vaccine against Nipah virus. Nipah is a disease that's carried by bats, and if it infects humans, it causes a hemorrhagic illness, very high fatality rate. Fortunately, it doesn't spread very easily between people, and so it's not so hard to contain outbreaks, but it's a really serious infection. And that's, again, a fairly simple virus, and we just take one protein from the Nipah virus genome and add it into the adenovirus, and in the same way, we can get an immune response against the Nipah protein instead of the coronavirus spike protein. Some of the other vaccines I've worked on have used two different viral vectors. So one of them is the adenovirus, the other one's a pox virus. So that's a relative of the smallpox vaccine. And again, that's safe to use in people. It doesn't spread through the body and cause an infection after you use it as a vaccine. And again, you can add genes from other viruses into it. And to get a really strong immune response, giving two immunizations, first with the adenovirus and second with the pox virus, gives a very strong response.
So is that is that the platform technology you were talking about, where you can just add the spike protein to a mild virus?
Yeah, so there are different platform technologies. ChAdOx1 is one platform technology. The pox virus that we use, that's a different one. And you can use them together when immunization with each. So RNA vaccines are also a platform technology where you just use the RNA encoding the protein that you want to be expressed. But then you have to modify the RNA because naturally occurring messenger RNA is very unstable. excuse me, we don't want it to hang around for very long because the way our body controls how things happen is to turn on the genes for making proteins and then turn them off again. And if the messenger RNA in our bodies was to hang around for a long period of time, then the body would continue making that protein. And normally we only want to make it for a short time and then stop. And that's how everything is controlled. But for the RNA vaccines, they've been chemically modified. So the bases that are used are more stable. And that means that you get longer period of expression from the RNA vaccine. And then to get it into the body, it has to be formulated in a lipid particle. So they're tiny particles, little balls of fat with the modified messenger RNA inside. And again, it's platform technology because you can just choose the genetic sequence for the whichever protein you want to make and then plug that into your manufacturing system and make different messenger RNA vaccines.
During the clinical trials, if there were any, what things did you have to change during them?
Mostly what we did was they just got bigger and bigger. Clinical trials always start off with healthy adults, usually fairly young, healthy adults, because we want to follow everything that happens to the people who get the vaccine in the clinical trial. And as you get older, or if you've already got some pre-existing disease, it's more likely that some medical event will happen to you. And it's very difficult then, if it's a new vaccine, to know if that's anything to do with the vaccine or if it was just something that was going to happen anyway. So we start with a population that are not likely to have anything happen to them, although we have to record everything. So it's a serious adverse event if somebody has to go to hospital for any reason. So if somebody falls off their bike and has to go to hospital because they've fallen off their bike, if they're in our vaccine trial, we have to record that. And then you have to have a committee deciding whether that particular serious adverse event is related to the vaccination or not. So everything gets recorded and then it gets assessed later on. So once we've started with a small group of healthy young adults, usually between the age of 18 and 45 or 55, we want to know about the performance of the vaccine in other age groups. For COVID, really important to know how it works in older people. So our next group was 56 to 69 year olds. And then the next group was 70 plus. And only recently have we included children in the clinical trials. To begin with, we thought we might be looking at children quite early because with other respiratory viruses, things like flu, children get infected and they might not get seriously ill, but they're really good at spreading it around the population. And so that's one of the reasons that we have the nasal spray flu vaccine, the Flumis vaccine that sprayed up the nose, because stopping children from getting infected with flu actually protects a lot more people as well. It turns out that's not the case with the SARS-CoV-2 coronavirus. Although children can get infected, they tend not to spread it around very much. So it became less important to think about immunizing children, although that has been happening more recently. We also needed to expand the trials to add in people in different countries, because sometimes people of different ethnic groups can respond differently to vaccines, or sometimes the environmental bacteria in the place you live can have an impact on your immune system, and that means you respond differently to vaccines. And we want a vaccine for the whole world. So it's really important that we started testing it at lots of different places in the world, not just in the UK. So we started in the UK, but then we expanded into Brazil and South Africa and into Kenya. And then when AstraZeneca came and joined in with us, they also did trials in the US and South America, also in India and Japan. So trials around the world to get data to make sure that it's going to work in everybody. That all takes quite a while to get going. And we don't get efficacy results from all of those trials. Some of them are just quite small trials, but the main ones that we had running were in the UK and Brazil, and then later on in the US.
You said something about that children don't spread COVID-19 unlike flu. Would you mind like elaborating on that?
Well, it seems that children, when they get infected with coronavirus, don't produce a very large amount of it. It's not that they can't infect other people, but when children get flu or respiratory syncytial virus, which is another respiratory virus that infects children, they seem to produce an awful lot of virus, and it means that they're very good at infecting other people, and for some reason that's not the case with the coronavirus.
Thanks. What are the major changes and differences that were made to the normal process of development so that you can make the COVID-19 vaccine in 12 months?
Well, we knew we needed to go really, really quickly. So in normal vaccine development, you do one stage of it and then you stop and review the results. And all of this work needs to be funded somehow. So we would, as a university, we would have to apply for some money to do the first part of the work. And just applying for the money can take a year. And then we do the first bit of the research, make the vaccine in the lab, test it in some animals, review the data, and then we would publish a paper, and then we'd go and try to raise some more money to go on to the next stage where we start manufacturing it for the clinic, and then raise some more money so that we can actually do the clinical trials. And that can take years to get through those early stages because it's just stopping and starting all the time. And we knew that we couldn't do that last year. So we started all of the different activities that we knew we would need to get to a licensed vaccine as early as we could. And that meant doing a lot of things at risk. And that doesn't mean a safety risk, it means a financial risk. So we started manufacturing the vaccine ready for clinical trials at the earliest possible opportunity. And we started applying for permission to do the clinical trials at the earliest possible opportunity. We had to wait for our preclinical data to be available before we could finalize the position, the permissions for doing the clinical trials. And if that hadn't gone well, we would have wasted money and we would have wasted effort in the manufacturing. But it did go well. And that meant that then we could move on very quickly to the next stage. And it's quite common to do a phase one trial in a few hundred people and then stop and review the data and then move on to the phase two trial where you add in the different age groups. We didn't do that. As soon as we had data that showed it was safe and it was giving a good immune response in the phase one trial, we expanded into the phase two trial. So we had about a month between starting phase one and starting phase two, and phase three actually started the next day. So phase three is when you get into very large numbers of people and you're following them up to see if the vaccine's actually protective. So because we had safety data from the young adults, we could start the phase three trial in the young adults. And then as soon as we had safety data from the older people in the phase two trial, we added those into the phase three. So it was a continually changing and adapting clinical trial protocol to enable us to go as quickly as possible. We still had to satisfy all of the regulatory requirements and keep providing data back to the regulators, but they reviewed it very, very quickly. Normally, if we wanted to start a clinical trial, we would do all the preclinical work on the vaccine, we do all the manufacturing and produce a massive dossier on all of the results of that work and submit it to the regulators once it was complete. And they might take a couple of weeks to review that and then come back with questions. We didn't work that way last year. As soon as we had any piece of information, we gave that straight to the regulators and they started to review it. And then we just kept adding and adding to that. So each time they only had a small amount of additional data to review. And when we got the final pieces of information about the vaccine that we wanted to use in the clinical trial, they didn't have very much more work to do to complete that review process. And they gave us approval very, very quickly. So that's not a very efficient way for them to work because it means they're constantly looking at our applications to do the clinical trials. But last year it was so important that we got these trials started quickly that that's the way they chose to work.
How long did your other vaccines take?
Well, none of the other vaccines I've been working on have got licensed yet. This one has overtaken everything. The other ones are going at the normal pace where it's sort of 2 to 3 years before you get the phase one trial finished. And then we have to apply for more money and try to move on to the next stage. So this is so much more being completed so much more quickly. So one of my colleagues today has announced some very good results from a malaria vaccine trial that's just been done in Africa. That vaccine's been in the works for about 25 years. Malaria is a very difficult disease. It's not so difficult to make a vaccine against something like a coronavirus. It's a small and fairly simple pathogen we knew which gene we wanted to use in the vaccine because it's the one that's on that makes the protein on the surface of the virus. Malaria is a very complex parasite. It has far, far, far more genes, and it expresses different proteins at different stages of the life cycle. And it can also switch the proteins that it's displaying on the surface to fool the immune system. So that's a really hard disease to make a vaccine against. And although we've done a lot of work in the last year in speeding things up and using new technologies, it doesn't mean that we're going to easily and quickly be able to make vaccines against all the diseases that we still need vaccines for, because in some cases, there are reasons why it's really difficult to do that.
Is it difficult to get enough and varied people for clinical trials?
Well, not usually. We're normally very lucky. So before last year, we'd been doing clinical trials for lots of different vaccines, malaria amongst them, MERS, chikungunya, which is a disease that not many people in this country have heard of. But we have a lot of students in Oxford. We have a lot of medical staff. We have people who are interested in science and biology and medicine and often willing to come and take part in the clinical trials. And they're often very highly educated population who understand very well what we're doing with our clinical trials. So we really benefit from that because people find it interested and they want to help develop vaccines against some of these other diseases that affect people in Africa and Asia. And also taking part in a vaccine trial, some people find it a very interesting thing to do. And it's a way of learning more about some aspects of science. And then last year, we were just overwhelmed by the response for people wanting to take part in the vaccine trials. So many people realized how very important it was to have a vaccine against this disease. And not only our vaccine trials, but all the other ones as well, were swamped with people really wanting to take part, partly because I think they hoped they would be protected themselves, but also many of them just wanted to help to get us out of the situation. And this was true in other countries as well. So I was hearing from the chief investigator of the trials in South Africa earlier on today, and he said there they were turning people away because so many people wanted to come forward and take part in these vaccine trials. So we didn't have any difficulty in recruiting people for the trials last year.
What were some of the difficulties for you and your team during the development of the COVID-19 vaccine?
Well, what was difficult, because it was new, we hadn't done it before, and I don't think anybody else had either, was to go at such speed. And that meant planning all the different aspects of the trial from the very beginning and trying to think about organising the testing in animals, organising the manufacturing, organising the clinical trials all at the same time, whereas normally we'd only have to think about one of those at a time and then move on to the next one. So we were frequently planning for something that was sort of two or three steps ahead, but we had to start getting plans in place. And we had to keep adapting our plans as we wanted to expand the trials, continually responding to the needs to change. And the other thing that was really difficult was actually developing a vaccine against a pandemic virus or against anything at all while you're actually in a pandemic, because we all had to work with social distancing. So suddenly we couldn't just come to work and work the way we normally would. We had to have far fewer people around in the labs. We had to start wearing masks. We had all the protocols in place in case anybody who had any symptoms of coronavirus. In the clinical trial site, we would normally have groups of people coming in and hearing from doctors some information about the trial. Well, we had to switch to doing all of that with videos. We had to expand our clinical trial site. We've now got two mobile clinics, which are the kind of things you'd normally have at festivals where it's, you know, a lorry turns up and unfolds and you've got a building on the back of a lorry. We've got two of those, quite big ones, to use as our clinical trial centres because we just needed more space, partly for the numbers of people who needed to come in and partly for the ability to keep them all separate and to have a one-way system and, you know, keep people moving. We needed a lot more staff. And that actually wasn't quite so difficult as it might have been, because the fact that so many other research activities had stopped in the university meant that people weren't allowed to come onto the campus unless they were working on an essential project. So they were being stopped from doing their normal research around about this time last year. So some of them did come and work with us, and the medical staff and nurses as well couldn't do their normal research, so they came and worked on our trials. And then we had the job of trying to manage a very large team that didn't normally work together, but everybody was so determined to make all of this work that actually everybody did a really good job of working together.
Do you believe the vaccines are the key to eradicating COVID-19, and how do you think it will affect the spread?
Well, I don't know that we're going to be able to eradicate COVID-19. I mean, so far, there's only one human disease that we have eradicated, and that's smallpox. And there's another cattle disease, which is rinderpest. So that's like measles in cattle. Getting quite close to eradicating polio, but not done yet. And it would be possible to eradicate measles as well, but that would take a lot more work. So in order to eradicate the disease, you've really got to vaccinate the whole world. And we're not doing so well on that front so far. We, you know, doing very well in this country, and Israel's got most of its population vaccinated, but across the world, only a small percentage of the population is vaccinated. And so there's still a lot of spread. We are going to need vaccines to bring down the spread in combination with so-called non-pharmaceutical interventions. So the social distancing, the lockdowns and all of those things, that will reduce spread. But if you come out of lockdown and you haven't got a vaccine to use widely in the population, then it's going to bounce back again, and you're going to see that spread starting to come back very quickly. So it's important to use lockdowns and other measures to reduce the spread. But if we want to keep it low, we have to have a vaccine. And then we have to keep monitoring the mutants, the variants of the virus that are circulating, because the vaccine is less effective against some of them. And it doesn't mean that it won't do anything at all. It will probably still stop people from getting seriously ill and having to go to hospital, but it might still allow some spreading of the virus between different people, and we really want to try to minimize that as much as possible. So it may be necessary to have updated versions of the vaccine in the future, but as soon as we can reduce the spread with non-pharmaceutical measures and then keep it low with vaccination, the less chance the virus has got to mutate. So it's very important that we try to get vaccines to everybody in the world to really suppress this. And if we can suppress it to a sufficiently low level, then it's not rapidly moving between people and being given the opportunity to mutate into something that then the vaccines really don't work against. So I think we'll always have to keep an eye on it. And there may be small outbreaks from time to time, even with the best measures that we can take. But I think it's going to be something that we can live with in the future. And there are four other coronaviruses that regularly infect us. They come around in the winter, and again, they give us a bad cold. And we don't know that it's a coronavirus any more than we would know if we had an adenovirus infection. And it's only really dangerous in babies and old people, or people with very weak immune systems. So I think that COVID-19 may eventually move into that category, where most people have got enough immunity to it to fight it off and not become seriously ill.
Thank you
so much. This was like so interesting. And I just loved hearing all about it. I made loads of notes. This is really interesting about the aspects of like the trials and how you kind of continuously went with them first trial, and then you did the second trial, and then straight after you did the third trial, clinical trial. And I think just how you were able to develop it in 12 months is just incredible. And it was so interesting listening to you today. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's been a very big team effort for 15 months now, and we're still going. So still got some more to do.
Thank you so much for letting us interview you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye.
So there you go. And as I said in my introduction, there were so many nuggets of fascinating information. We had a blast making this episode, and we hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. Thank you so much, Professor Sarah Gilbert, for letting us interview, and thank you guys for listening. You can reach us on Twitter at TheSlightlySci, or contact us on our website, slightlyscientific.co.uk, and we have new episodes every month. Thank you so much for listening. Have a great day.